that we use, this is the transmission rate. And currently, our R-naught right now is 1.46 for Metro Manila. So if you say you have a 1.46 in Metro Manila, for every 100 cases, you are infecting another 146 cases. So it means that you are doubling by as much as 50% this number of cases that might we might have because of this transmission rate in the country.
So in short, if there's a reported number of 10,000, for instance, yesterday, in terms of that projection, how many might actually be carrying that virus but not reported?
Well, if you say it's 10,000, and then if it's about maybe 25,000.
So I just want to give the public an idea of how serious this problem is, because even if you rely on the official figures, there are still those
This is the Philippines. We are ANC.
The Philippine Health Department recommending a one-week extension of the enhanced community quarantine in Metro Manila and nearby provinces. Private hospitals struggling to keep up with the avalanche of new COVID-19 cases. We'll talk to the head of the Private Hospitals Association of the Philippines, Incorporated. President Duterte giving the go signal for private firms to procure their own COVID-19 vaccines. Presidential advisor in entrepreneurship Joey Concepcion will speak to us about the advantages of this move. And the Liberal Party says the opposition's best bet in the 2022 presidential race is still Vice President Lenny Robredo. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Hi, thanks for joining us. And for those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, nice to have you with us today. If it were up to the Philippine Health Department, the enhanced community quarantine in Metro Manila and nearby provinces would be extended for another week. President Rodrigo Duterte announced new quarantine restrictions for parts of the country Monday night, but kept the ECQ status for the National Capital Region, Bulacan, Cavite, Laguna, and Rizal until April 4. Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergeres says the duration of the ECQ should be at least 2 weeks to see its impact on the country's COVID-19 case count and healthcare utilization.
We won't even see any changes in our numbers. We might see more numbers after this 1 week, because what we are seeing right now are the numbers 2 weeks prior to this week. So we are still going to see an accumulation of these numbers for the next 2 weeks. So 1 week really is short. It takes about 9 days before we can isolate a specific individual who is positive for COVID-19. And why so? Because it takes about 3 days for people to decide if they would want to be if they want to seek consult for their symptoms or not. And then once they seek consult, it takes another 2 days for them to get tested. And then the results, the waiting for the results, and then eventually being isolated. We have this R-naught that we use. This is the transmission rate. And currently, our R-naught right now is 1.46 for Metro Manila. So if you say you have a 1.46 in Metro Manila, for every 100 cases, you are infecting another 146 cases.
Vergere also admitting gaps in government's COVID-19 response, such as testing and isolation.
We have almost done almost 50,000 tests per day for this past week. The target would be, as what the experts would say, we should be targeting 100,000 tests per day. And that is the objective. What would be most critical also, that once we test, we also need to isolate immediately. These are the gaps in the system right now that we can see, that there is this delay in isolating or quarantining people. That's why the transmission is happening. So our isolation and quarantine facilities has to be prepared also.
As Malacañang adopts a wait-and-see stance regarding the ECQ status of the NCR Plus bubble, the rest of the country has been placed under the most relaxed quarantine classification next month. President Duterte announced Monday most of the Philippines will be under a modified general community quarantine, or MGCQ, from April 1 to 30. However, two areas in the Cagayan Valley will be under the second strictest quarantine classification. Quirino Province will be under Modified Enhanced Community Quarantine, or MECQ, from April 1 to 15, while the city of Santiago in Isabela Province will be under MECQ from April 1 to 30. Other areas will be under General Community Quarantine from April 1 to 30, including Batangas and Davao City. The new quarantine classifications come as the number of new COVID-19 cases in the Philippines hits more than 10,000 for the first time on Monday. It's the fourth straight day that daily infections exceeded 9,000. The number of active cases now at over 115,000. 16 new deaths and 78 additional recoveries were also recorded. The health department says if government did not enforce a stricter lockdown in the so-called NCR Plus, active cases could reach 430,000 by the end of April. $23 million Filipinos set to receive aid from the government following the reimposition of ECQ in Metro Manila and surrounding provinces, Budget Secretary Wendell Avisado says. The money will come from the 23 billion pesos of unutilized funds from government's second pandemic stimulus package. According to Avisado, local government units can decide whether to give the assistance in cash or in kind in the form of food aid. But he stresses this will only be a one-time assistance.
It really would depend now on the local government unit. Opo. Kung ikakas nila para mas madali o kung yung bibili pa sila ng mga pagkain at iriripak nila, kailan naman nila matatapos yan at yung sistema ng pagdidistribute pa. Samantalang kung cash naman ay pupunta lang nila yung mga bahay-bahay at papalistahin nila at papapirmahin nila dahil may report of utilization po yan na required ng COA yan.
For Bayan Muna Party List Representative Ferdinand Gaite, government's planned aid will not be enough for the millions of people who lost their jobs due to the pandemic.
Kulang pa yan para sa mga batayang pangangailangan ng pagkain at iba pa. More so na ngayon, nakita nga natin ang dami nagkakasakit. We're hitting 10,000 a day. And so nonchalantly, this government is saying maliit na bagay ito. I do not know where the head of this government, where his head is. So Duterte must take his full responsibility for the downturn, not only of the economy, but also the health situation of our countrymen.
With COVID-19 infections in the Philippines rising at an alarming rate, President Duterte finally allows the private sector to buy COVID-19 vaccines on their own. The Philippine government previously said companies and local government units can only purchase vaccines through a tripartite agreement. Under that agreement, the national government takes responsibility for any adverse effects from the inoculations, while vaccine makers are immune from suit. But Duterte warns local companies from taking advantage of his latest order.
Baske mag-ilang kano, ilan ang gusto nilang ipasok, okay sa akin. Ito bang nagpapabili ng mga fake, itong nag-i-import na yung walang source, tapos peke. I'm just warning you. Wag na wag kayong magkamali dito na hirap na ang Pilipino, tapos dagdagan mo ng ganitong pamaraan ng hanap buhay. Pupulutin ka talaga kung saan. Hindi ako nagbibiro.
Local business groups have been calling on government to allow private firms to purchase vaccines on their own so they can protect their employees. And for more on this development, joining us now is the Presidential Advisor for Entrepreneurship, Joey Concepcion. Good afternoon, Secretary, and welcome to the program. Thanks for joining us today.
Good afternoon, Carmina.
All right, so it was a welcome move, welcome announcement coming from the President. What made the President issue his announcement anyway, abandoning the previous model of having government's presence in these procurement deals with pharmaceutical companies, Secretary?
We can't abandon the agreement because under these vaccines, no, all over the world, the private sector is not importing vaccines. It's only in the Philippines that we have offered to our government. So to be able to do that, we had to structure a tripartite agreement last year. That was together with the CEO of AstraZeneca, myself, and Secretary Galvez. Now, the tripartite, what is important about that, it protects the pharmaceutical company and the private sector from suits, no? Because these vaccines have been developed over a span of just 1 year. While their safety has been seen and efficacy during on all phase 1, 2, and 3 trials, it doesn't mean that these vaccines are just free to go anywhere. No? So these pharmaceutical companies will not sell the vaccines to the private sector without the government being a part of it.
Right. So now that the President made that announcement, though, how would you qualify procure at your own will? Will government still be present as these various companies strike deals with various pharmaceutical companies, Secretary?
The key of buying the vaccines is getting the pharmaceutical company to agree to sell it to you. First, you give the supply. Then, number two, how will you cover them as well? So, likewise, the private sector, since we are buying the vaccines, how do you cover the private sector from, you know, anything that happens? So there has to be an indemnification, which when we signed the first tripartite agreement last year, both government, private sector, and pharmaceutical company, that AstraZeneca, then now the law was done and it includes indemnification. So I don't think that the private sector will do it their way, because and pharmaceutical companies will definitely want not to change the game, no? Because even Moderna is already using the same tripartite agreement that we started with. And likewise, Novavax and Covaxin, the other vaccines that are going to be purchased by the private sector, the tripartite is being done and mirroring basically the first and second agreements that were done already. So yeah, I'm glad that the President is allowing the private sector to be, and the government telling them to be more flexible with the private sector. But I have to say that with the help of Secretary Galvez, he's been very flexible and he's been very quick to really get us going with this tripartite agreement. And I have to say that we're the only country in the world that the private sector is buying vaccines. It's supporting the government as well.
All right. So this announcement of the President saying that the private companies can now procure at will, are there going to be any conditions set by government? Because previously they were allowed to buy for as long as they also donate to the public. There was a one-to-one ratio there. Go ahead, Secretary.
The donation, in fairness, AstraZeneca program was zero profit. So AstraZeneca was giving the doses at $5. No? If you were to buy the vaccines being sold right now, they're anywhere between $26 to $15, no? Even as high as $20. So the AstraZeneca's price to us is very low. But that was really intended for government. It was just unfortunate that government could not really avail of this, because back then, that early, AstraZeneca did not have any MHRA approval. No? So what we did is Astra and us decided, let's help government, because anyway, giving us these doses for $5. So we said, let's give half of what we buy to the government. And so that's how it started. No? We wanted to help the government for the frontline workers. Now, in the case of Moderna, Novavax, and Covaxin, since these are already sold at market prices, they cannot afford to anymore donate to the government. So the government has never forced us, I'd like to make it, to donate. This is through our own, wanting to help the medical frontliners. Now, for the rest of the other vaccines that are being sold now by the pharmaceutical companies, of course, this is for profit. The pharmaceutical companies are making money on this. So they cannot afford to donate anymore.
The President also last night warning people who might take advantage of the situation to profit from it. But I want to get your thoughts on this, because in the early days of the procurement stages, there were those who were saying that government was the one who was actually profiting from the importation and the sale of these vaccines. Can you give us your thoughts regarding that, that government was never really, or was government really responsible for, you know, blocking these vaccines from reaching the people? Go ahead, Secretary.
No, in fairness, Secretary Galvez has been working so hard, and, you know, the private sector will not fool around. I mean, if we see something wrong, we're going to just walk away from it. But in fairness, the Secretary Galvez and his team have been so transparent. I mean, the prices are what we see is we were paying at the same price, basically, for the vaccines that the government is paying, and vice versa. So in the terms of speed, the government can do certain things to their limits. No? Private sector, of course, we can move faster because it's our own money. We don't need to clear it with too many people. If the CEO says, let's buy the vaccines, then that's a go. But for government, there's a process. Then they have to secure funding from World Bank and ADB. Mm. So those takes time. But we can, our private sector, we have the money. We just borrow from the bank. So we can move faster. But I have to say that the government has been very transparent with its pricing on the vaccines. And we will see if there was any corruption. And I can say for the vaccines that we bought together with the government, it was very transparent.
All right. So talking about, you know, moving faster now, I want to know what your projection is. Once those vaccines start to come, once the private sector really puts their money into motion and gets all these vaccines, how soon can we see tangible efforts here or tangible effects of this?
So we had a meeting with Secretary Galvez and USEC Mirna. So what the private sector is preparing right now is the arrival of the AstraZeneca's first batch in May and June. So we're doing another tripartite agreement, which will cover DOH, Zuelic, which is our choice of logistic provider, and ourselves, being the private sector, who will be paying. So now we're going to pay for the implementation part. No? Mm. In the case of Moderna, Novavax, and the rest, they already included it in the price. No? So the government will not be burdened with the implementation and will not even pay for it. So what we want to see is an end-to-end solution. So with AstraZeneca arriving in May and June, Zuelic will be the logistics company. They will take the vaccines from the plane, bring it to their warehouse, and distribute it to the different private sector companies and batch one that's ordered. And now we have our own separate provider who will also do the vaccination of our employees. We will now submit the number of people that will be vaccinated to DOH. We will have a list of these names and submitted. They don't require the names, but they're requiring a number of people. If they want to check the names, they can so do check the names. So we will be entrusted to implement our own 50% in the case of AstraZeneca. With the others that are arriving, and bulk of the vaccines will be arriving in the third and fourth quarter. Basically, AstraZeneca's 14 million will be arriving in the third and fourth quarter. 2.6 or 3 million is arriving in April, May. And the third quarter is basically AstraZeneca with about 14. Moderna is arriving third and fourth quarter. It's about a total of 12 million plus private sector, 7 million. Then you have got Novavax also arriving in the third and fourth quarter. So the bulk of the vaccines will be coming in basically in the third and fourth quarter of the year, just in time for Christmas. And hopefully we implement using third-party providers approved by DOH to implement really fast. We want to execute the vaccines and vaccinate all our employees. And we're now campaigning that all our employees do accept to be vaccinated. So we have medical information. We're bringing them videos about why is it important to be vaccinated and how safe these vaccines are.
Yeah, and talking about how safe these vaccines are, how will you able to safeguard now that, you know, some companies, we know about big companies, right? They have the connection. But what about smaller companies who do want to vaccinate their employees? What is the safeguard there so that they won't be able to procure substandard vaccines?
When they join the group, basically the dose of Hogodinosho endorses all of these distributors who are bringing the vaccines for private sector. So we pass these orders to them. So they're assured that whatever the big companies are buying, they are accessing the same. So we go through with this, with of course, with DOH and Secretary Galvez and AstraZeneca, Moderna, Novavax, and Covaxin. These are well good brands and with good efficacies and good safety, protocols. In other words, they're safe vaccines. Of course, there are side effects, and that's why DOH has implemented certain rules on when you vaccinate them. And the implementers like Zwelling and so many others out there who will be vaccinating, you'll have the ambulance, you'll have to, everybody being vaccinated has to wait for 30 minutes. So all of these are outlined already in what will happen. QR codes, everything. Mm. So, Zwelling is using blockchain. So it will eventually, it can lead to the vaccine passport. No? So this is where the private sector moves really fast. No?
But what about MSMEs? What about MSMEs?
Okay, so our 50% donation to the government, we have requested Secretary Galvez to direct this donation to NCR. And if they could focus it in our micro, small enterprises, sari-sari store owners, palengke, carinderias, tricycle drivers, etc., no? Those vendors. So we are requesting Secretary Galvez, since we are donating to the government, please direct it to the National Capital Region, which is the epicenter of the infection of the virus. And please focus on the micro and small, which our LGUs anyway will support. So Secretary Galvez has agreed. And also Chairman Abulos, I've informed him, and also the mayor. So this is about 1.3 million doses that will basically, 1.3 million people will be helped with this donation.
Okay, we're going to have to leave it at that. But there's one question that's been nagging a lot of people, and that's why have this sort of an arrangement only now? People are saying if this arrangement would have been done in the beginning, then we wouldn't have seen the economy suffer as much.
No, in fairness, we really worked hard with Galvez. We secured it last year in November. That's when the program started and ended. So first batch was completed then, and the second batch was completed in January. And AstraZeneca was the only one. Now, could we have gone after Moderna? Yes, we were trying. I'm sure Galvez was trying. But remember, the powerful countries can push their way around, no? And we're not there. But we were able to at least cover for a number of people. And I'm sure, we got COVAX through Secretary Galvez, got WHO COVAX facility. We're one of the 89 countries. So, I mean, with all what we have done in our efforts, I think it's quite decent. Could we have done more? Yes, maybe if the financing was available right away, and the government could have just bought more, but the ADB and World Bank financing took a bit of time.
Mm. But how will it change things now? Now that we have the president's announcement that the private sector can buy their vaccines on their own, how will that change things?
The tripartite should not change because it is really the best that has happened, and everybody is implementing it. What may change right now is that maybe it can be reviewed whether a tripartite is really needed. So we have to look at the indemnification law if a tripartite is needed. But in the end, we are already towards the tail end of most of these vaccines are already being procured and or have been procured already.
So basically, there's no new announcement here because you're still going to have that tripartite agreement, and it's still important for that agreement to be finalized between two parties. So there's no change here, really.
The change is that the president has given importance to the private sector and sees the need that the private sector should really have more leeway in suggesting certain things to the public sector. I think that's the biggest change. He wants the private sector to be protected as fast as possible. So I think that's the change. Now, the procedure is already there, and it just gives a very strong signal to the people, government, DOH, and all of that. Please pay attention to private sector needs.
Hmm. All right. We're going to have to leave it at that. Presidential Advisor for Entrepreneurship, Joey Concepcion, keep safe. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you. Thank you, Carmina.
Take care.
Thank you.
All right, the local government of San Juan City begins vaccinating its senior citizens and individuals with comorbidities today, Tuesday. Our correspondent Angel Movido joins us now with the latest. Angel, go ahead.
Yes, Carmina, Health Secretary Francisco Duque III and the National Task Force Against COVID-19 Deputy Chief Implementer Vince Bidon led the COVID-19 vaccine rollout for senior citizens and persons with comorbidities in San Juan City today. According to Duque, San Juan's vaccination site at the San Juan Arena is one that is ideal, especially for senior citizens and those vulnerable, as it is well ventilated and can accommodate hundreds of vaccinees, keeping social distancing. According to San Juan City Mayor Francis Zamora, they target to inoculate around 200 to 300 senior citizens today, simultaneously also with those persons with comorbidities. AstraZeneca vaccines are being administered to senior citizens, while the Sinovac jab is being...
Angel? Okay, we seem to have lost Angel there. We're going to try and reconnect to establish a better connection with her. But our correspondent Angel Movido there telling us that in the city of San Juan, they've begun inoculating senior citizens and people with comorbidities. They expect to vaccinate thousands today. We hope to have Angel back on the line. In the meantime, the patients, they keep coming. The hospital workers, they're running on empty. One would think this is a description of hospitals in 2020, when the country was first hit by the pandemic. But no, this is the current situation in hospitals as we speak. Let's now talk to Dr. Jose Rene De Grano. He's president of the Private Hospitals Association of the Philippines, Inc. Dr. De Grano, welcome to the program and thank you for joining us today.
Yes, good afternoon, Ms. Carmina.
How are you doing?
Well, we're fine here, although the hospital is full.
And how would you describe what is happening in the private hospitals today, Dr. De Grano?
Well, the problem right now is, especially in the urban areas like the National Capital Region, our hospitals are really at the critical level of occupancy. And when you say that it's critical level, it's 85% or more, and even 100% full. And we still don't count the people who are still lining up at the emergency room and those patients who are still on the way or are being transferred from other hospitals.
Dr. De Grano, how would you describe the nature of the infections that you've been seeing? Are they moderate? Are they mild?
The good thing is around 96% of these infections are mild and asymptomatic. And that's why we are trying to ask people to reserve the COVID beds to people or to patients who are moderate or severely affected, rather than, you know, fill up the hospital beds for patients with mild or no symptoms at all.
But if it's 96% who are mild and asymptomatic, how would you then explain the critical level in ICUs?
The ICU is only a small part of a hospital, probably less than 5 or 10% of the hospital beds. And then, of course, there are also people who are already in a critical state. That means that they need the ICU confinement. And they are only, actually, they comprise around 2% of the infections right now, but 2% of around 100,000 is that's too much also.
Yeah.
So it's not really a small number.
Correct. And for those that you described who were already in critical state and that's why they had to be brought to the ICU, were these people previously quarantining at home and were only rushed to the hospital because they've entered that critical state?
No, usually these people, people are what you call when you are infected, then of course you if you think that you are already infected, you go and have yourself tested. When you are tested and becomes positive, then the local government unit or the CESU, MESU will call on you and take you to the LGUs or the quarantine areas. Mm-hmm. Or if you have symptoms already, then you go directly to the hospital. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, if you go to the hospital and they find out that you are having more or less a severe symptoms, then, of course, they will probably bring you to the intensive care unit if you really need the more critical evaluation of your sickness.
And, you know, Dr. Degrano, last week I was talking to Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergere, and she was saying that the plan really was, and still is, to decongest hospitals by making use of isolation facilities, because we need that breathing space for the hospitals. As I said earlier, you guys are running on empty. But based on your assessment, what is the weak point in the link here? Why isn't this happening for the most part?
Well, actually, the government is doing everything. They have the one hospital command right now. We can coordinate with the different hospitals where to transfer patients if the hospitals are full. But then the problem here probably is, of course, people would like to be confined in their favorite hospitals. They want to see their own doctors treat them. That's the problem with the one hospital command. If you are brought to another hospital where you don't want to stay because that's far from your place, or probably you don't even know the people there. And so that's why we are requesting that patients who have very mild symptoms and those without any symptoms at all don't seek the hospitals. They should go to the quarantine area so that, you know, we can decongest the COVID beds of our hospitals.
Yeah, and the problem here is it's the extreme, Dr. Degrano. We were talking about this with Dr. Vergere last week. Mm-hmm. On one hand, you do want to go to the hospital, as he said, have the best medical care that's going to be provided by the people that you know, the doctors that you know. But on the other hand, there are those who just want to quarantine at home and they don't really want to go to the isolation facilities because it's more detrimental to their mental health, they say. But the result of that is the cluster infections that have been happening.
Well, actually, they are going into that thing, you know, because that's one option that they probably would be doing as long as the, you know, your house has an isolation area or another room where you can isolate the infected members of your household. But, you know, in the Philippines, those are not too many, you know, only for those who can really afford or who are in the upper class of the society, that they have a lot of rooms in their houses. Mm. But then that's why these people who have really only the mild symptoms and the asymptomatic ones, they should really not be admitted at the private hospitals or the hospitals, and they should really be brought to the TTMF, or the temporary treatment and monitoring facilities, which is also the quarantine facilities of the local government units. Mm.
What have you been seeing, Dr. Degrano? We know that the variants that we have now are highly transmissible, but what's the recovery rate at this point? Are more people dying?
Actually, as per data submitted, most people who are in the senior age group, the senior citizens, they are the ones with a high number of you know, deaths. Mm. While those who are younger, they get afflicted also, but you know, they can easily survive in after maybe 10 days or 14 days. Mm-mm. But you know, the nature of this disease is you have to stay for a minimum of at least 2 weeks.
Mm-mm. And that's why right now, when various LGUs are beginning to inoculate senior citizens, I mean, that's going to, what do you think? Is that going to have a major effect on the numbers that we're seeing once these senior citizens get vaccinated, Doctor?
Hopefully it does, because, you know, there are a lot of senior citizens and they are at the priority A2 list already. Mm-mm. So if you vaccinate them, it will take another 2 weeks. And then for the second dose, will take. It depends on the vaccine. And after that, the second dose, then most probably you'll have, actually the vaccines itself do not really prevent the infection. No, it only prevents more or less the severity of the disease right now.
Right.
Because it's EUA.
I want to talk about staffing now. That's a major concern as well. The DOH says they're on top of that. Are they? Is the department helping you to staff understaffed hospitals?
Actually, we are, the private hospitals, even before the pandemic, we already lacked nurses, you know, because nurses kept on resigning, going abroad. And then government then offered higher salaries. And so most of our nurses went to the government facilities. Mm. And our estimate is around 40% of our nurses resigned because of those things. And now after the pandemic, we only have a few nurses now. The main reason for most of our hospitals downsizing is first the funding, and number two is the lack of nurses. Yeah. And so that's it. But we are trying as much as possible to cope with this.
How?
Well, as much as possible, if we can afford the number of beds, let's say, because the Department of Health has mandated to increase our number of beds to 30%. We can only do that if we have the additional number of staff that we can afford. Sometimes we will have to sacrifice the non-COVID areas and get our nurses from there to go to our COVID areas. Mm. And then, of course, we are expecting also, some of our hospitals are expecting, if it's true that the government will be giving us augmentation personnel to man the extra beds of our COVID cases.
And talking about things that are running low, I want to talk about these drugs supposedly to treat severe cases that are reportedly running low. Are you able to restock right away? Because the situation that we have is also happening in other parts of the globe.
Yes, actually that's unfortunate, but it's more of a supply and demand thing. So there's fairly an increase in the demand, and so the supply has gone down. So, but they are saying, our suppliers, they're saying that they have already ordered and that it's coming in the next few weeks.
Coming in the next few weeks. So you don't, you don't expect that your treatment of COVID patients will suffer because of this. You still have enough stock.
It may, because what they are doing now, our suppliers, let's say I'm ordering a lot. Mm. They cannot give us everything because they have to apportion it to the other hospitals. And so that's it. That's what they're doing right now.
So when you say it may affect the treatment for severe cases, what's the end scenario there if you don't get the stock when you need it?
Well, that's the most that we can do. If the stocks are available, then okay, we give them, because the drugs right now that are approved in the Philippines are remdesivir and the Tosi thing. And so the Tosi drug right now is almost, the stocks are very low right now. But I think the other one, remdesivir, is still available, although it has gone up, the price has gone up.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Dr. Jose Rene de Grano, you keep safe, you take care, and you hang in there.
Thank you very much, Ms. Carmina.
Thank you. That was Dr. Jose Rene Degrano, president of the Private Hospitals Association of the Philippines, Inc. And we have this just in. One of the Philippines' iconic singers, Claire De La Fuente, has passed away. She suffered a heart attack Tuesday morning. Claire was 62 years old. Her son says her body was immediately cremated. Claire was known as the Karen Carpenter of the Philippines. She was the country's jukebox queen in the 70s, making hit after hit. She later ventured into the transportation business with her own bus firm. Our condolences. We're going to take a break now. Up ahead, we'll focus on Myanmar, where the bloodbath continues despite sanctions imposed by the U.S. over the violence against anti-coup protesters. Dateline Philippines will be right back. Stay with us here on ANC.
Think about the millennials and the young physicians coming out of medical school. They look for work-life balance, they look for flexibility, they look for consistency, predictability in their lives. We'd like to continue to push with the schools, and we're working with quite a few of the big schools to promote primary care, especially to incoming and current medical students. About the millennials and the young physicians coming out of medical school, they look for work-life balance, they look for flexibility, they look for consistency, predictability in their lives. We'd like to continue to push with the schools, and we're working with quite a few of the big schools to promote primary care, especially to incoming and current medical students. Thank you. think about the millennials and the young physicians coming out of medical school, they look for work-life balance, they look for flexibility, they look for consistency, predictability in their lives. We'd like to continue to push with the schools, and we're working with quite a few of the big schools to promote primary care, especially to incoming and current medical students.
Reported earlier, the local government of San Juan City has started vaccinating its senior citizens and individuals with comorbidities today, Tuesday. Our correspondent Angel Movido is back with us on the line with the latest. Angel, go ahead.
Yes, Carmina, as of today,
Angel. Yeah, sorry to cut you there. There you go. You were coming in choppy. I think this is better. Go ahead with your report.
Right. Yes, San Juan City Mayor Francis Zamora estimates the remaining population of senior citizens, that's around 6,000 more, are on a wait-and-see mode, as most still have access to the meantime, those with comorbidities should be able to respect the medical certificate, hospital or surgical record, or the doctor's prescription within the last 18 months. Qualified are those persons with chronic respiratory disease, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, malignancy, chronic kidney disease. Vaccinees are given a vaccination card after getting jabbed for Sinovac.
We're not hearing a lot. Your audio is coming in choppy. Angel, sorry to do this. We're going to have to cut your report. Hopefully, the full report will be on our succeeding newscast. Angel Movido there. Thanks again. Keep safe. Now for the Philippines' opposition party, Vice President Lenny Robredo remains to be the most qualified candidate for the presidency in 2022. Liberal Party Vice Chairman Franklin Drilon, however, said Robredo has yet to decide if she is running for the highest position in government. Drilon adds the party has taken no official stand on rumors it will be supporting the possible candidacy of Manila Mayor Isko Moreno in next year's elections.
I have heard of this. But that the Liberal Party has taken an official position, no. We have not even met to discuss this. And maybe we should meet in order to discuss this. Right now, there is no question that Vice President Lenny Robredo, to us, is the most qualified to be the next president. She is our vice chairman. We will support her, but the matter of running is a personal decision.
An advocacy group says security forces in Myanmar have killed over 500 people in nearly 2 months of trying to quell anti-coup protests. The Assistance Association for Political Prisoners, or AAPP, says 141 were killed just last Thursday, the bloodiest day in the crackdown so far. One of the main groups behind the protests urged ethnic minority forces to help those standing up to the military's oppression. Three other groups call on state forces to stop killing peaceful demonstrators and resolve political issues. The U.S., meanwhile, has suspended all trade engagement with Myanmar until the return of a democratically elected government. But Western sanctions have failed to sway the military junta that continues to hold the country's elected leaders in custody. And we'll now talk to an activist in Myanmar who asked that he remain anonymous due to the dangers of speaking out against the military junta. We will instead call him Jeff for his safety. Hi, and welcome to the Dateline Philippines, Jeff. Thanks for joining us today.
Hi, it's a pleasure to be back.
All right, so how are you? How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty well. I'm alive, so I should be thankful for that. But as you have said before, many others have sacrificed their lives for democracy in Myanmar.
Tell me about the level of fear that you're experiencing right now because of the many deaths that have happened in recent weeks. Jeff? Jeff? Okay, we're going to try.
Hi, sorry, I missed your question. I couldn't hear.
Okay, there you go. I was asking you about the level of fear that you're experiencing right now, owing to the fact, of course, that there have been numerous deaths that have happened there in Myanmar in the past weeks.
That's right. I think it's safe to say that everybody is fearful of losing their lives, without a doubt. But what we are more fearful of is having to live under a dictatorship again. And we are willing to sacrifice our lives at risk it all than have to accept a life under a military dictatorship.
With the deaths that have happened, has that sort of strengthened your resolve that it was enough, it is enough to offset this level of fear that you're experiencing?
You're absolutely right. As you know, the military, it is quite clear that they are willing to do the utmost barbaric atrocities that any human could think of. And so they have signaled to us that they are willing to go as far as they can. And that only means that we have to go as far as we can as well. And of course, for the 500 people that have lost their lives because of the military regime, it would be in vain if we just stopped everything that we're doing. It would be in vain if we did not continue to fight for their cause. So it has only strengthened our resolve. As you can see, every day there are protests still happening around the country. In fact, today is it's a remarkable day because today is a trash protest where everybody puts out the trash of their house from their households on the streets. Mm-hmm. So people are coming up with creative ways to safely protest against the regime. And where it is safe, people are still on the streets, especially in cities outside the larger cities, smaller cities. So as you can see, even despite what the military has done to us, our resolve is still strong, and we will continue to resist to the bitter end.
Is there one leader that's leading the protesters? Is there anyone that's willing to be the face of the protest actions against the junta?
There are several groups, of course, the CRPH, the committee representing the parliament, they are not involved in organizing protests, but they are, quote unquote, the face of the opposition. Mm-hmm. And of course, we also have the General Strikes Committee, which consists of former politicians and unions. But other than that, really, there's no one face. And, the protests are being organized by neighborhoods, being organized by student unions, and just friends who happen to live together. And I think this is the advantage, because right, if we have one head, then they are able to cut off the head of the snake. But now we have many heads, so they won't easily be able to cut us off.
As you correctly pointed out, this is what makes it powerful, because there's no one person there. It's all of you.
That is right.
How are you able to communicate, though, under radar for the military not to really know your every step? Jeff?
That's absolutely right. And now, hi, can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
Right. So, you know, now in almost every neighborhood in where I live, the military and police are at every corner of the street. So we really have to be careful meeting up with other people, other organizers. But yet we continue to still do so. We rely a lot on encrypted messaging apps like Signal and Telegram. So these have these apps have really changed how we're able to communicate, because the military is not easily able to tap to our into these messaging apps. But other than that, of course, I mean, when we have to go out, we have to go out. And despite the risks that are involved, we just have to accept that the possibility of getting shot, beaten, or burned alive, which is what's been happening across the cities, is there.
Before we got you on air, we were reporting on how the U.S. has suspended trade sanctions with Myanmar. Is there fear now that as other nations suspend trade engagements with Myanmar, that this might make not just the junta suffer, but ultimately the people?
You're absolutely right. And my what I always say is, if the junta did not want people to suffer, then they shouldn't have launched the coup in the first place. But like I've said before, the people's resolve, I mean, as you've already said, 500 people have given up their lives, and thousands have been arrested, and millions have protested. This is all to show that despite all the challenges and the sacrifices they'll have to make in terms of their income and the economy, people are more fearful, and people despise a military dictatorship, and that is strong enough, that is so strong, that even if the economy collapses, we are willing to accept the cost of it.
Well, we're going to have to leave it at that. Thank you for joining us today, Jeff. He's an activist there in Myanmar. You keep safe.
Thank you so much.
Take care. And that'll do it for today. Thank you for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcast. Playback this newscast too on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on ANC.
The overseas voter registration for the 2022 Philippine elections is still open until September 2021. Bring your valid Philippine passport and, for dual citizens, your supporting documents to the nearest embassy, consulate, mission.